Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today, continuing with the series of videos I'm doing about MLOps with MLflow, we will do today an experiment on hyperparameter tuning and log all the activity metrics, artifacts in MLflow. We are going to work today as execution environment in Databricks. And we will use therefore the MLflow capabilities that had Databricks. You probably know that Databricks is the, well, now I would say the owner of the MLflow. Before it was an independent library which had as third party, but probably a couple of years ago become an integral part of the, what you know as a Databricks workspace, and is fully integrated in Databricks. So you don't need to do anything when you to install MLflow in that in this scenario, because once you have created your workspace, is already install MLflow with and the only thing that the case that you are working in an enterprise you may want to do is to probably centralize the tracking server, and well, there is some options that you can do, but well, most of the cases you don't need to do anything. As I said, everything is integrated on the Databricks workspace, and you just need to, many cases, just activate autolog in the in your experiments, or block insert your the activity that you want to log into MLflow inside a block code with inside a with block. With MLflow start like we did in a local execution environment, and we don't need even here to set up the tracking URI. Is everything set up for you? Again, once you create the workspace, the all the environment variables, the tracking URIs, everything is set up for you, and you don't need to worry about that. So once you have created your Databricks workspace, you just launch it, and that's it. The first thing that you need to do is create a cluster, a compute. The name is compute, but essentially it's a Databricks cluster. You need to choose. We are not going to go into too much details about Databricks. We will just cover the necessary to understand the experiment. I'm planning to do a series of videos about ML in Databricks, ML, AI, generative AI, everything that you can do in a Databricks environment, which is a lot, to be honest. But today we will not focus on that. We will just focus in what we need to run an experiment. It's going to be an experiment of hyperparameter tuning, which also is somehow complicated to do. If you are working in a local environment, you can do it, obviously, but it's much more complicated. Databricks is designed as is a distributed environment, and by design, can handle these processes where you need to run multiple processes at the same time, because obviously, by definition, a cluster is a number of computers, boxes, dockers, containers, name it as you want, grouped in a single entity, which is known as a cluster. And then in these clusters, you have workers and a special component, which is the worker, which is the one which is organizing and optimizing the process, and sending chunks of job to the different workers that you have in your cluster. To work with MLflow, two things to note: you cannot work with Databricks community. You maybe was wondering why we are not using the community edition. It's not possible to integrate with MLflow. And secondly, you need an ML runtime. We will not look at well what is the difference, but essentially you can have it as well with the standard runtime, but you need to install it on purpose. Just install with PIP, and if you choose a ML runtime, you have it already installed on it. So the differences in between ML, non-ML, and GPU, non-GPU, where you can take a look to release notes and that's it. So then on, depending on which kind of account you had in Database, I had a trial with 14 days, and then on there is plenty of limitations on the trial. But just to run this experiment, choose one of the smaller templates like this, and just choose one worker, maximum one worker. And then you can choose a spot instance. Yeah. And well, just don't worry. That is enough for what we're gonna do. And again, you usually have the same template. You use the same template for the driver. The driver is not more than a worker plus some additional components to orchestrate the activity of the workers, and also an optimizer, which attack optimizer, which take the job and make optimizations in how to be run this job, and split it, taking into account the number of the workers that you have and the capacities of those workers. And then in this case, we are going to use very basic configuration, just one worker and everything in just a single machine. You can do that using as well single node. Okay? And then you use a single node, you had everything in one computer. Nodes and workers and the driver. So you use multi-node, you had two nodes, one is a worker and the other one is the driver. But the driver as well is a worker. So the only thing that again, there is at least two additional components installed on the driver. One is the scheduler and the other one is the optimizer. And then for you, again, choose this one and one, or directly go to a single node. The rest you can keep it by default, and keep an eye on the number of DBUs that you are going to spend. Depending on your account, you will be able to create it or not. In my case, with the trial, I was able to create a single multi-node with one worker and one driver. You create computer and you will get something like that. You later can edit if you need, but for this, again, not really necessary to do it, because what we are going to do is trying a random forest classifier for a binary classification problem, and then we will optimize an XGBoost for the same purpose. And well, in this case, we will just use the boss as it is. So just keep in mind that when you work with non-distributed algorithms, which are designed to work in a single computer, it doesn't matter what you do, how many nodes that you have. You will just be using the driver in this case. And it doesn't matter how many nodes you have. That is the case of the XGBoost. the version that you may download and install in your local computer. This version is not designed to run in a distributed environment. And a random forest classifier as well, not a PyTorch library is not designed to run in a distributed environment, but they are designed to run in a multi-processing environment. And to use the multi-process capabilities of the computer, we will use the library HyperOn op. This is a library for optimization. We will talk about later. And then on what happen when you use HyperOp and in an environment like Databricks, if you just had one node, you will be using multi-processing on that node. That is the case that you use a single node. And in the case that you had multiple nodes, imagine that you have four, you will be, first of all, splitting the trials among the different workers. And then inside the workers, you will be using different processes. Okay. I repeat to make it clear. When you were in a computer with these algorithms that are not designed to work in a distributed environment, they are designed to work in multi-process. Multi-processing, you assign to a process a estimator or a piece of the program which is doing the training. You can parallelize this using multiple processes in the single computer. But then when you do this in a distributed environment, you can use different workers, and then on you can run different processes. In this case, in the case of hyperparameter tuning, different trials of your space search space, and these different processes can be in different workers. To do this, we need to use some specific classes of HyperOn, and you will see now on the experiment. In the other hand, if you are using a library like MLlib from Spark, which is designed to run in a distributed environment, it will be Spark, in this case Databricks, using the DAG optimizer, who the component which will decide to which worker send the trial. Yeah, it will prepare a trial and it will be sent to a worker for execution. Yeah, and once the execution is done, you receive the output back to the driver to later on combine all these outcomes and choose which one is the best one. No? So this is an important concept. So the algorithms, for example, scikit-learn, PyTorch, deep learning, transformers, etc., they are designed to run in a single computer. They are not designed to run in a distributed environment. So when we run it, if you don't use a library which allow you to manage the different workers that you had in the cluster, everything will run on the driver. With libraries like MLlib, which are designed to run in a distributed environment, this is happening in all the clusters available on the cluster, and it is the DAG optimizer, the component which distribute the jobs or the tasks across the different workers. Okay, having explained how this works, let's go to start with the sorry, I think my cluster is down. Yeah, exactly. After some inactivity, 120 minutes by default, the cluster terminates automatically. This means that everything that you had in memory is down, and then you need just to start it again. So it's gonna take a couple of minutes after the cluster is as we had the spot instances. We need to request to Azure. In this case, I'm working in Azure, but it doesn't. It's exactly the same, the process in Google Cloud or Amazon Web Services. So now we need to wait until we get the resource. Once we get it, we will continue. Okay, once it's done, we can go to our workspace. And I had this example. This example is from Databricks. It's not mine. It's from a training course. There is plenty of these examples available in the Databricks documentation. It's just focusing on how to work with MFlow. I will do another note about how Python works in Databricks. If you use just simply Python commands in Databricks, all of them are going to be executed in the driver. So Python as well, the same that the algorithms are not designed to work in a distributed environment like Databricks. So you are working with Pandas, with the Python, with the PyTorch, whatever you use is not designed to work with in a distributed environment. You can use the driver, because at the end of the day, the driver is not more than a Linux box with Python installed. Apart of Python, we had PySpark and Spark library. And if you want to use libraries that work in a distributed environment, you have to use PySpark. And data frames, PySpark data frames, algorithms that are designed to work in top of PySpark. PySpark is not more than an API to Scala. All that you write in PySpark is under the hood for execution translated to Scala, which is the native language used by Spark or Databricks in this case, which is not more, Databricks is not more than a commercial version of Spark. And again, everything that you are going to be here, when I see here, especially when we use Pandas or we use other stuff, is being executed on the driver, which is, again, is a Linux box with some libraries, and then we are using the Python that we had installed in that box and using as well the integration with MFlow. We will see other in a separate video how to work with the algorithms, native algorithms in ML of MLib, the library of the machine learning library of the Spark, which natively work with Scala or PySpark. And I don't remember one also with Java and R. Because these four languages can be used in your they don't remove it, we just need to activate it. Also, you can write as well programs or notebook in SQL directly. But again, in order to work with all the clusters and optimize the jobs, you need to write code in PySpark and use libraries which are designed to work in a distributed environment. So everything that we're going to see here is going to be working on the driver, because this is not prepared to work in a distributed environment. Everything except HyperOut. HyperOut had a module and a class which allow us to distribute the different trials of our hyperparametric tuning experiment across the different workers. But this is a special case of a Python library which have a component which is designed to work with Spark, with the Lawrence Spark. Okay, so we are going to work with a data set which is part of the workspace, the wine quality data set. This is on our Databricks file system. In the folder, when you create a workspace, this is installed with the workspace, and it's in the Databricks file system. We have two files there. One is a white wine, a red wine. So we just create a single data frame. This is Python, pure Python. We are not using here anything special, and we are just creating a data frame to do a binary classification problem. The binary classification is going to use all these attributes from fixed acidity to quality, and then on we create a label with this is red. So we have here some visualization. This is part of the exploratory data analysis. It's pretty much what you can do in your local computer, but here on the notebook. And here we are just training a baseline model. We are splitting the data set in 60-20-20, training validation tests. And here we are just training a random forest classifier like baseline to understand what is, well, a Bayesian algorithm, a random forest, without any optimization, and see what is the bottom, that the minimum case, the minimum AUC that you can get with an algorithm. No? Here, to lock the model into MLflow, again, as I said before, MLflow is fully integrated, is part, integral part or Databricks, but they decide in this case to use a Python model. We can use essentially simply with MLflow start run, as this is part of the scikit-learn. You can use just simply autolog, and it will MLflow it will do everything for you. But in any case, they use a wrapper. Just watch the videos in the channel. We had a couple of them where we show how to use the PyFun and the Python model with transformers, with LLMs, and with custom models that you may have for different purposes. And here they just wrap the random forest into a Python model. If you remember, you need to the Python model had two methods. One is predict, which obviously you understand what is. You override the method of the root class with the particular logic to do a prediction with the model that you are working on. And the other one is load context, which you don't need to override it if there is no need. In this case, you had the method from the root class, which is simply pass. In this case, we are not using it. If you watch, if you look the videos that I uploaded before, we will use essentially the load context method to instantiate the tokenizer, the model in LLMs, and for some other stuff. And here we just simply start a block of like we did on the local execution with MLflow start run. We get a name. Simply give me this to show you later on something. And we just simply, this is pretty much what you probably did many times, is just fitting a model. Then on here we are logging to MLflow the estimators, the AUC that we got. Then on we grab the model in the class, in the Python model class. We create just here. And we create the signature for this model with using one prediction. And we create the environment. I will explain you why we create the environment now. We just lock the model to the experiment. In Databricks, especially if you are working with a model like Random Forest, that is essentially a Python model, a Random Forest classifier, is essentially a Python model. And then on, if you understand how MFlow infer the environment to create the necessary metadata to load the model in any other environment. MFlow, what is looking is to the environment where this experiment is running. And this environment is a little bit specific because this is a spare environment. And if you capture the libraries that you have in this environment, many of them are libraries that are designed to work in an spare environment, and these libraries cannot work without many effort into a Python environment like your local computer. Unless that you are running this in a Docker, it's going to be practically impossible to replicate the environment where now is running this experiment into a new one. And then for that reason, here we are just creating the environment manually. Okay? And this here makes sense. You probably heard me in previous videos that I'm not very happy to allow or to create this because it's tend or prone to error. O sea, you can miss some libraries in your conda environment and cycling, and then well, it's difficult, it's more difficult to do it manually, but in this case it's really necessary. If you do it in your local computer, it's well, it's if you install more than necessary, well, it's just a matter of performance. But is you know that the model is gonna work in another environment, in another Python environment. But here, in an spare environment, yeah, it's probably something mandatory to do it manually. And that's why we create a conda environment. You can create as well a Python environment or a virtual end environment. But here, well, they decide to create a conda one with only two libraries. PIP dependencies. Okay? They don't specify conda dependencies or conda channels. So here, as you see here, they start MFlow, and you can go to the experiment just clicking here or clicking directly here to the RAM. If you go to the experiment, sometimes take a while. It's another jar. Oops. Why we? Oh, yeah, probably. You go to experiments. Maybe we can click here. Simple. Suck. Come on. Again, login. Ah, sometimes when you lose the. Yeah, exactly. This. So you can see the experiment had the same name of the notebook where you are running the experiments. And here. Ah, exactly. You can see we can run again this stuff, but essentially the previous run, the model, the cluster terminate. That's why now some of the links are broken. But well, this is the first experiment, and you can see here that well, it's exactly the same. We look at AUC, the number of estimators also was something that we log here. Log metric, log parameter, and the artifacts will log the model as well with our signature, etc. etc. You see here that we have the model registered. We see this now. So now to create a you will see here that we are creating this feature important data frame, which is automatically created when you use Autolog. As we didn't use Autolog here, Autolog is possible to use with scikit-learn estimators or algorithms. In this case, we didn't use it, so that's why we need to create it ourselves. And then we just created, and here, well, the baseline is AUC 0854. You can see here the AUC, And now we can, yeah, you can do this search runs with the name Antoinette Random Forest, which is the name that we put here for this run. But also, you can use the run up. What is this? Oh, sorry. We can use run. And you can get the same as well from this run. Oh my gosh, it's not gonna. Yeah, it's exactly. Sorry, we need to run this to show you. Give me a second. Let's run all this again, all these cells, just to show you what's going on here. Cycle run, we just run. So here it's gonna run. Now we are running. Is again, yeah. If we click now here, I hope that is going to the. No. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. You see here we had this new one. Yeah, and here you see it's not registered, okay? And we had in artifacts the same model and our AUC is 85. So now if you execute this, you will see that our run is oh. Dictionary, and you get everything that you saw the run ID. So here what is doing is just using the search capabilities that have TensorFlow to look into the metadata in our database and to look for this experiment and to return the run ID. Here, exactly, it's taking the first, and then you can get this doing like that. And then, if you see here, the run ID CC is exactly the same that this one, so you can take directly the run ID from the object run, transforming it in a dictionary. Yeah, so you can use the same. There's multiple ways to do exactly the same. Now what we're gonna do is register the model in the model registry with the method register model. We will use the model that we have in runs, in the run ID, and in the folder random forest. Let me show you that. So you can see here random forest. And this is exactly the same that to register the model clicking here. So you just click. And one quality exists. So now it's doing version 3. So we can go to the models. Now we have one quality. So it's no stage. This is the model registry. They implement as well a model governance workflow. So when you register the model, directly go to stage none. And oops, let me return to the notebook. Oh. Yeah, exactly. And here, created version 3 of wine quality. Here, now we are going to use the transition underscore model underscore version stage to transition the model to production. And then now you go to models. You will see here that this was transition to production. Okay, now we take the we load the model from the model registry. If you watch the videos I upload before, we used to point to the run to the experiment, but you can do exactly the same when you have the model registered in your model registry. You just can get the model here. Probably was here we register the model using the one we have in the experiment, and here we are loading the model pointing to the tag in the model registry. So we load it from the model registry, and we pass to prediction the test data frame, and we get the EUC of 0.085. Now we are going to do a hyperparameter tuning, and in this case we are going to use HGBoost. So for this we would use HyperOdd. HyperOdd is a Bayesian optimization algorithm. It's a library which is created to do this kind of optimization. It's using these three different algorithms, and by default use TPE, and well, it's working essentially as a Python library, but has some extensions to work with Spark. You can take a look to the different algorithms that they use in getting started. Two algorithms here exactly, and how it is work. But essentially, you create a search space with the parameters that you want to optimize. In this case, master, learning rate, alpha, lambda, mean child weight, and the objective is always the same: is binary logistic, because this is a binary classification problem. You create a optimization function. The optimization function always receive params. Params is gonna be a trial, a version of the of this search space. So it will be a value for match there, a value for learning rate, a value for rec alpha. With these values here that you see here, we are doing autolog from XGBoost, and we will create a new experiment. When you see nested equal true, this is going to be nested, or sorry, yeah, nested in under an experiment, which it will be the root experiment. We will see this later. Here, just simply create the train and validation data frames, and we create a booster with the HGBoost train parameters for the training data frame, now Boston run 1000, evaluation data frame, and early stop run 50. So we do a prediction, we calculate the AUC, we lock the AUC of this experiment, we infer the signature of this training, of this trial, and we create the signature, and we return the values to the main experiment. The main experiment is running the minimization function of the HyperOdd. I will explain you now this. Here, one note. This algorithm, fmin, is the only one in TPE algorithm, is only used for minimization. So this is designed to minimize a loss function. In this case, as we want to maximize AUC, is how we design this experiment. The trick is to convert the score that you get into a negative, so multiply by -1. This case, you are transforming the value into a negative number. So the algorithm will understand this as bigger is the AUC, the best is the trial. So to work in Spark, they have this class, Spark Trials, which using parallelism, you will decide how many workers you want to use in your cluster. So in this case, we are saying 10, but Again, here we just had one worker, so it's not gonna do very big effect, no? So it will be running one by one, or in maximum two by two, because we had in this setup in my cluster we had a driver which is a worker, and we have a worker, separate worker with only the functionality of work. Now we start the main experiment, and we receive the best parameters here, and we using the F function minimization, we pass the train model, which is this function, objective function, the search space, which is defined here, the algorithm to use, the maximum number of trials that maximum number of trials that the algorithm will generate, and the parallelization to be used. Case that you don't have 10 available, it will use what you have available. We run it, it's gonna take a while. So here it will start the process. Again, it's gonna take a while, so I will stop here, and once it's almost finishing, I will be back. In this case, again, we are working with Python algorithms, with Python language, so it's not gonna be very efficient, because we had a very small cluster, but again, it will take some time. 12 minutes is reporting here. We will see. You can take a look now to the experiments, what's going on here. Sorry, this is the models. Oops, session expired. Experiments. If you go to the experiments, now it book another. Another, load more. Exactly, we had the first. Here, it's just starting. It's creating all these. Some of them are already done. Why already done? Because we have an early stopping clausule. So when Echibus understand that there is no better option, automatically shut down the trial to speed up the process. So some of them are discarded very quickly. So, but in any case, per experiment, you are logging, you can enter in one of the finishes, you are capturing everything, because as you remember, we set up autolog, and then on MFlow is capturing everything, logging the model, calculating, also creating these graphs, even in JSON format, logging the model, logging the metrics of the training, etc., etc. So let's wait up to this is done. We are 33. In some minutes, we will continue. Okay, this has finished it. We can take a look now to the trials. You see everything are done. You can just go to one of them. This is the main one. The best trial is 89.99. So 19, and it's aggregating everything on the route, and yeah, you can take a look to the individual ones if you just have interest, and yeah, in artifacts there is nothing, obviously, because this experiment is just orchestrating the other. And if you go to one individual one, we already were there. You just will get all of them contains the same, and just having the different parameters. You can take a look here, and you can click here. and introduce whatever parameters, learning rate, for example, you see maxdet, algorithm, whatever, rec, alpha, lambda, estimators, maximum, yeah, to check. You can see here and see which parameter use in that specific trial. So now we are going to search for the best. Obviously, this is the best. This is belonging to the previous model, to the previous run. So maybe the best here is just, well, come on. I didn't write the run. Well, so here, typically what you should do, so yeah, best parents here, we are not going to get the best parameter. So here you just get the best parameters. You can now look manually. Yeah, I forgot, sorry, to put here as run, because now as we had two runs with the same name, so usually here you don't put these kind of things. You put well, you can put XGBoost model, but you can also you need to introduce a timestamp mark, because it's not what's going on here. As we have two different, I did an experiment before for the video I did in Spanish, so I had now these two. The previous one had a slightly better metric, and then is now when we make a search, it's finding the metric of the previous algorithm. But in any case, the process is exactly the same. Good practice is to introduce here a timestamp, and also right here as run, because if you do it like that, we can do run it again. It's gonna take again 15 minutes. We will get all the values of this experiment in the variable run. But okay, we can continue. We just get the previous one. We now find the mod. The best run now is having a run ID. Yes, we are looking on the metadata here. We just get all the parameters. Best run here. You can write to dictionary. Where is that exactly? MLflow run ID, best run tags. That ML flow that root run ID. Oh, sorry, this is the D. Oh, come on. Ah, no, it's run ID, sorry. It's only this. Sometimes I forgot, yeah. And you just get, we just register the model, looking at the runs, and yeah, we are creating the version 4, and then on we transition the model, the previous model here. This one is going to be transitioned to archive, and the version 4 to production. And then it's now, you refresh here. Exactly, you already have it here. Archive the version 3, and the version 4 is in production. And now we look at the model, we load the model, pointing to the URL in the model registry, and we just get the AUC 90, which is better comparison with the 85 that we got at in the baseline, a 5% of improvement. And now we are going to do batch inference. Batch inference is only possible, you only can do it using a Spark data frame. We are going to create a data frame from the X-train, from the training data set without labels. We just create a data frame with the Spark class. Create data frame, we use a pandas data frame, and then on we save it into the data lake, into the Databricks file system in Delta format. We are not going to discuss what is that, and then we are just transforming the data the pandas data frame into a Spark data frame. We create here a PY fan with flavor Spark UDF. This is a Spark UDF function which will apply in this case we will apply the model to a Spark data frame. We will see now this is one of the functionalities, wonderful functionalities that had Spark. You just create a UDF function and you apply you apply the function, in this case we apply a model to the we just apply a model, the model is going to be what we have here to so the flavor is Spark and the model is what we had in the model registry in production. This is going to be the version 4. So we just create the function, take a look to this specific implementation of the PY fan. You can load it in Python or you can load it in Spark. And then on with we read the Delta table now with Spark. You just simply schema. Exactly, and we display the new data. So you can see here that we had the Spark data frame, and now here we are going to transform the table into a structure to just input the UDF function, and then on with the method with column of the Spark data frame. We take the Spark data frame, we apply the method with column, we give a name to the column. In this column, we are going to introduce the prediction of passing all the inputs. The inputs is not more than the X-train data frame in Spark format. We pass this to the UDF function, which is apply the model for prediction to the data frame, and then this will create a new column with the name prediction, and there we will have the predictions of the model. Now we just do a display, and you can see here that you will have a new column, so you can see here that everything is working now in Spark, the prediction column. The last version is we will see it in a separate video how to serve this model in an endpoint for production. There is different technologies that we can use to do that, but we will see it in another video because it's not, this is going to be very, very long. Okay, that's all. I hope that you find it useful. It's a really wonderful technology, Databricks. You just need to know how to use it correctly. But for big data problems, you have no choice. You need to work with Databricks. And as you see here, we can use how to say, Python technology, which is not suitable to work properly in a distributed environment, we can adapt it using some libraries, and then we can transform it and use it all the possibilities that Databricks and the distributed environments provide to us. In other, I'm thinking to prepare a different set of videos where I will discuss and show you how to use Emerlib and properly Databricks with all the functionalities using distributed libraries. And some other libraries that also work with Databricks to, for example, do distributed training of the neural networks, some stuff like that, which is also very interesting. The library is Horobop. But again, we finish before all the stuff with Emerflow, and then we will move into other interesting topics. Again, thank you for watching. I hope you like it and you find it interesting and useful for your work or for your training. And if it is like that, just give me a like, subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before, and also share with your friend and colleagues as to help me to promote my channel. That's all. Thank you very much. See you soon.